Muy bien. Buenos días para todos.
Good morning, everybody.
Un gran pensador contemporáneo.
A great contemporary thinker called Emmanuel Levinas said, thinking about someone else and looking at the face of someone else all begins when we say good morning. So good morning, everybody. I call to order this third meeting of the ninth session of the Forum on Minority Issues. And we thought that before we resumed with the list of speakers under item 3 on the agenda, it would be very good and beneficial to give the floor to the Special Rapporteur, Ms. Isaac Dniane, for a brief intervention. You have the floor, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, I am taking the floor this morning in light of the discussions we had yesterday and the repeated disruptions that were rather unfortunate given the significant delay we already have in our agenda. I would like to remind all of us that Human Rights Council Resolution 19/23 on the Forum on Minority Issues decided that a Special Rapporteur on Minority Issues, myself, shall guide the work of the Forum, prepare its annual meetings, and make recommendations for considerations by the Human Rights Council. I have carefully drafted a set of recommendations about minorities in situation of humanitarian crisis, which is in front of us today, to guide our discussion. I strongly appeal to all of you to keep your interventions focused on these recommendations and contribute to putting this important document in final shape so it truly becomes representative of all our views and thoughts. It is therefore crucial that civil society speakers frame their interventions accordingly, do not use language against the spirit of our constructive discussion, and also that state delegations only exercise their point of order when there is a procedural reason for it, and avoid interruption of the interventions in case there is a disagreement on the substance. In case you wish to exercise a right to reply, please do approach the Secretariat, who will try to accommodate such requests. And please show respect for all interventions equally. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a unique platform provided to us to be able to shape international legal norms and standards on minority rights protection. So we, the few who are privileged enough to be in this room, cannot afford not to use this opportunity wisely and forget why we are here. For the millions of minorities in humanitarian crisis who are looking to this forum's work with much hope and expectation that it will result in strong recommendations that can help member states and others in taking the right action to improve or even remedy the desperate situations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Ms. Special Rapporteur, for this reminder. Very well. We have a delay of 40 minutes behind the planned timeline. You know that we have 2 days of work. There is a lot of desire and determination to speak. There is a lot of passion for what we are trying to do, because we are addressing one of the most crucial issues of current times. I wish to reiterate what the rapporteur said. It's true that we all intend to try to safeguard the quality of discussions and the good outcome of them. And once again, I would like to ask all speakers to stick to the relevant topic during their interventions. We have so many points of order raised yesterday that I would like to remind you that points of order are, above all, procedural. And in reality, they must not address the substantive content of interventions that they refer to. And perhaps if this occurs today, I will have to interrupt the speaker. And also, as also mentioned by the Special Rapporteur, member states that would like to respond to the substantive content of any interventions can, without any doubt, address themselves to the forum's secretariat, which will try to address their requests. And now I would like to invite the participants registered here to please stick to their 3 minutes. I have to say that there was no excessive use of time, but 1 minute plus 1 minute plus 1 minute takes us to a 40-minute delay, and we only have 2 days. You must realize that the whole world is looking at this forum, and it only has 48 hours of time. I'm saying that generally because we also use some time to rest and sleep, of course, but we do have very little time. So let's make the most of the time that we do have. And now we will begin to give the floor to those people that are on the list. And the list for item 5 has already been closed. I just wanted to remind you of that. The first speaker that we have, that I have on the list, is for the AFRI Forum organization. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. South Africa is on the verge of a humanitarian crisis. 2015 was the driest year since 1904, when the South African Weather Services started documenting rainfall. 2013, 2014 and 2016, South Africa received less than average rainfall. South Africa has a 37% unemployment rate, and because of the prolonged drought, another 38,000 South Africans have lost their jobs and income. The drought in South Africa threatens the well-being of the Afrikaner farmer community, as well as the greater South African public, and will have a negative impact on the entire country. Therefore, we believe we are on the verge of a humanitarian crisis. Afrikaners are historically referred to as boere, which means farmer. It is generally accepted that the majority of commercial farmers in South Africa are Afrikaners, the minority of the population. Ladies and gentlemen, the first victim of the drought is the crop farmer, who cannot harvest as all the crops have wilted in the drought, leaving the farmers in debt of millions. Prices of maize meal, one of South Africa's staple food sources, will drastically inflate in the coming years. The second victim of the drought is the livestock farmer. A livestock farmer will slaughter the majority of his herd to ensure the survival of the core breeding herd. It takes a livestock farmer up to 7 years to rebuild this herd up to its original size. Because of this, the price of meat in South Africa will increase in drastic steps. The third victim of the drought is the South African public. The majority of South Africans spend up to 60% of their income on basic food products. Therefore, the hike in food prices will make basic food products unaffordable in South Africa. The poorest of the poor will become even poorer. Mr. President, I want to put it on record that the South African government has done nothing of note to help the commercial Afrikaner farmer. Yes, the South African government allocated 212 million rand to 7 provinces in November 2016 after they were declared disaster areas. Now, this might sound like a lot of money, but in reality, in 2015, 114 million was allocated to 1 province after it was declared a disaster area. This 114 million rand was enough to last small farmers for only 2 days. Therefore, it is easy to see that 212 million rand will have little to no effect in 7 provinces. Several organizations warned the government of the coming crisis, but the incompetence or blatant unwillingness to address the coming crisis will have its true effect in 2017 and 2018. Ladies and gentlemen, history has taught us that people can survive many disasters for long periods of time as long as they have access to food and water. However, hunger does not listen to reason, and as soon as food becomes unaffordable, we will surely see a surge of uprisings from the South African public, which will weaken an already weak South African economy. The fact of the matter is that the entire South Africa is dependent on the Afrikaner commercial farmer, as it is they who contribute to food security in South Africa. By ignoring the minority Afrikaner commercial farmer in his time of need, the South African government will lead South Africa into a food security crisis. I thank you.
Thank you very much for your intervention. Now on the list of speakers, I have the Ogaden People's Rights Organization. You have the floor.
Mr. President, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, the Ethiopian government has created a constitution that accepted the right of self-determination of nations in theory, including the setting up of regional states. However, when the Somali people in Ogaden set up their own self-rule and attempted to exercise the right of foreseen in the constitution, the Ethiopian government refused to respect the autonomy, dignity and the right of the Somali people to participate in decision-making that affected them. It also blocked them from exercising their constitutional and democratic rights to hold free elections and instead used the Ethiopian army in Ogaden to select for them their representative in both the parliament and the administration. This resulted in a violent conflict in which the Ethiopian government used it as a pretext to abrogate all rights of Somali people and institute an undeclared martial law in Ogaden. The Ethiopian government even banned the ICRC and shot and detained two Swedish journalists who attempted to report from the Ogaden. What is unusual in our case is how the international community has ignored the conflict and the plight of the Ogaden people. The disagreement in Ogaden is similar to that of other conflicts in Africa and Middle East. However, in this case, no effort has been made to address those issues and stop gross human rights violations, despite overwhelming evidence. This deliberate sidelining is attributed to the geopolitical interests of key stakeholders in the Horn of Africa. We take precedence over human rights abuses. In addition, Ethiopia gets further leverage from hosting the AU headquarters. Even attempts by the conflicting parties to negotiate were not supported or even acknowledged, and the conflict is ongoing. To complicate the situation further, the conflict has now spread to other parts of Ethiopia, and the whole situation is bleak. The Ogaden People's Rights Organization believes that most of the recommendations proposed are positive. However, they are based on a model of government that are led by people with a minimum of morality, respect of the law, rule of law, and have a sense of humanity. When leaders of governments openly flaunt international laws and act with impunity, minorities are victimized with no recourse to justice. Therefore, OPRO recommends that this forum explore more the issue of non-compliance with international humanitarian rules and human rights laws. Once a minority complains to the United Nations, the right of the United Nations to intervene, to promptly investigate that must be an accepted norm. If the government refuses for the UN to initiate that investigation, more robust actions is needed. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your intervention. And I will now give the floor to the Liberation Group. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Siar. The Chittagong Hill Tract CST is one of crucial regions in Bangladesh in terms of conflicts and humanitarian crisis. Indigenous Jumo peoples of CST have regularly spoken about their problems relating to conflicts, militarization and population transfer perpetrated upon them since 1970s. These indigenous Jumo peoples have been struggling for decades long to safeguard their national existence and to establish right to self-determination. After a long struggle, they have compelled the government of Bangladesh to engage in negotiations resulting in the signing the CST Accord on 2nd December 1997 in order to resolve the CST crisis through peaceful and political means. The CST Accord had ended the decades-long fierce armed conflict between the Jumo peoples and government of Bangladesh. However, many crucial provisions of the CST Accord, including on demilitarization, self-rule government, return of land possibly taken over by settlers, rehabilitation of Jumma refugees and internally displaced families, mixed policing, preservation of Jumma inhabited characteristics of CST region and support, remain unimplemented. Although the former PCSS guerrillas have laid down their arms, a sustainable peace and recovering from the crisis is yet to achieve, and hence durable solutions is also yet to be ensued. Mr. Siar, the Jumo people are still under military rule through the Operation Uttaran Upliftment, which was imposed in 2001 after signing the CST Accord. Under this Operation Uttaran, the military forces can commit any kind of atrocity with impunity. Hundreds of military camps still remain in CST, and non-indigenous settlers continue to illegally and forcefully occupy our lands with the support of the government and the state military. In the recent past, they committed 18 large-scale communal attacks even during the past post-accord period after 1997. It is observed that the non-implementation of treaties, agreements and other constructive arrangements between indigenous peoples and states is a source of conflict. This is also true in Bangladesh, where CST remains largely unimplemented. This is a cause of the continuance of conflict situations. With this backdrop, in order to recovering from the ongoing crisis and ensuring durable solutions in the CST, I, on behalf of indigenous Jumo peoples, would like to appeal to the international community, including UN Forum on Minority Issues, to influence the government of Bangladesh for demilitarization of the CST region through withdrawing all temporary camps and de facto military rule Operation Uttaran, rehabilitation of Bengali settlers outside CST with dignity, declaration of a time frame roadmap for the speedy, proper and full implementation of the CST Accord. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much for your statement. I am now going to give the floor to Trieste United INGO. You have the floor.
And honorable members, the Trieste United INGO, representing the citizens of the territory of Trieste, would like to thank the organization of the Ninth Minority Forum for giving us the opportunity to be present and to be able to express our plight. Recent and current wars that have occurred between North Africa and the near Middle East are creating many problems to people who are undergoing these conflicts, and they are pouring into the European continent by the millions, people fleeing from tragedy. A large portion of these immigrants have arrived in the territory of Trieste, a territory in which to date its integrity and its independence is ensured by the Board of the United Nations Security Council, Section 3, Free Territory of Trieste, Article 21, Peace Treaty, Constitutional Law, November 25, 1952, number 3054. That's why we have come to you today, to bring light onto a growing problem that has befallen our territory. With the increasing rise of refugees escaping from war-torn countries and flowing into our territory, we are facing a major integration problem between the existing minorities and the newly arriving minority groups. In the territory of Trieste, we already have a multitude of existing ethnic minorities, from Slovenian, Greek, Serbian, Kosovo, Macedonian, American, and more. The problem faced by these ethnic groups is a complete lack of integration and cultural acceptance amongst themselves. The current administrating state of Italy has done nothing to integrate or unite the ethnic groups that currently live there. And now, with the increasing inflow of refugees coming in from around the world, the situation has taken an even more dramatic turn for the worse. We are seeing fear and hatred rise towards one another. The administrating state has not taken into consideration that when you simply deposit people without any guidance or plan of integration in an area that is already suffering a complete lack of social and ethnic unity, there can only be a rise in mistrust leading to hate and conflict. What we do not understand or know often brings out the worst in people. This is due to the fact that there has never been a course of action that guided the people to want to integrate and exchange their cultural differences, a sharing of minds and cultural differences that could help to build a unique territory. To date, the current administration of the Italian government, Memorandum of London, October 5, 1954, is not able to manage the integration of the new ethnic minorities entering the territory, nor the multicultural population already located there. They have not created the conditions for the real integration of these peoples, especially war refugees who are entitled to a better chance at life. Instead, and indiscriminately, they have aggregated in a territory which has no sovereignty, Article 21.2, refugees and economic migrants, together with other existing minorities, without having the appropriate reception facilities. Trieste is your territory. It could be a unique and protected land where the multitudes of ethnically diverse people that live here could do so with the possibility of being in a territory that is one of a kind, where cultural differences are embraced and nurtured, and the people that seek refuge are protected. There could be a system of integration and embracing of cultural diversity that, if were to be implemented, could literally blaze a path of unity and hope in a city that could become unlike any other place in the world. Now is the time to make the change. Thank you for listening, and thank you, Mr. President.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much for your intervention. I will now give the floor to the group Voices for Peace. You have the floor.
Thank you, Chairperson, to give me the floor. The failure to fully implement the Chittagong Hill Tracks that was signed between the indigenous Jumma peoples and the government of Bangladesh in 1997 for resolving the CST crisis through political and peaceful means has led to continued suffering of internally displaced families. And India returns refugees of Jumma peoples in the Chittagong Hill Tracks, who were the innocent victims of government atrocities and humanitarian crises in 1980s and 1990s. It is to be mentioned that during the armed conflicts between the guerrilla of the indigenous Juma peoples and the government troops in 1980s and 1990s, at least 12 massacres upon the indigenous Juma peoples were committed by the Bangladesh military forces and the Bengali Muslim settlers who were settled down in the lands of the indigenous Juma peoples of the CST in 1980s, bringing them from the plain lands by the government. As a result, around 100,000 indigenous Juma families fled to the deep forests of the Chittagong Hill Tracks, who were regarded as internally displaced persons, and around 15,000 families fled to the neighboring India's state of Tripura for shelter, who were regarded as international refugees. The CST Accord stipulates the rehabilitation of both IDPs and the India returning refugees and returning the lands of the home state backed with their occupied by the Bengali Muslims with the assistance of the government missionaries. However, though 19 years have been passed of the signing the CST Accord, no IDPs have been rehabilitated so far, since illegal state settlements of the Bengali Muslim families in the lands of the indigenous Juma peoples in 1980s, they have been regularly receiving food, grains as monthly ration. On the others, indigenous Juma peoples IDPs who were uprooted from their ancestral lands due to the massive communal attacks by the settlers continue to be deprived of receiving any humanitarian assistance from any of the governments or national or international humanitarian actor. In light of the above situations, I would like to appeal UN Forum on Minority Issues to pursue the government of Bangladesh for urgent action to the following for the sake of the sustainable peace, security and development of the Chittagong people. Number one, rehabilitation of indigenous Juma IDPs and returning Juma refugees with returning lands and homestead back to them. Providing financial and food support to indigenous Juma IDP as a means of preventing or mitigating the impact of humanitarian crisis. And the third, rehabilitation of the Bengali settlers outside CST with dignity. Declaration of the time frame, roadmap, and the speedy, proper, and full implementation of the CST Accord. Thank you, Honorable Chair, to give me the floor. Thank you.
Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you for your statement. I will now give the floor to the World Uyghur Congress. You have the floor.
Thank you. I'm speaking on behalf of the World Uyghur Congress to bring the forum's attention to the worsening situation facing Uyghurs in China. Uyghurs continue to be subject to highly restrictive policies in terms of religious freedom, freedom of movement, assembly rights, and adequate means of legal representation. As it stands today, the only legal religious practice that remains for Uyghurs.
Okay. Hay un llamado de atención por parte de China.
China has drawn attention I invite you to stick to the content, not the procedure.
Mr. Chairman, World Uyghur Congress is a notorious anti-China separatist organization whose goal is to split Xinjiang from China. And that organization has been long-term engaged in masterminding an organization of anti-China separatist activities. The organization is intricately linked to organizations such as the Islamic Movement of East Turkestan, identified by the Security Council as terrorist organizations. Minority foreign participants should abide by the purposes and principles of the UN Charter and respect the sovereignty and territorial integrity of states. It should not be abused by separatist elements. Should not allow the organization to be present in this forum. Separatists should not be abusing the forum for separatist activities to call for separatist activities in violation of the territorial integrity and sovereignty of the member states of the UN. China would like to reaffirm the forum should not be abused by separatist elements. Therefore, China would like to request you, Mr. Chairman, to stop the statement of this organization.
Suiza tiene la palabra.
Switzerland, you have the floor.
Merci.
Thank you, sir. Very briefly and most respectfully, I'd like to ask delegations to respect the right for civil society to participate in this forum and to allow the speaker to finish the statement. Also, the special rapporteur said that the secretariat should be addressed concerning right of reply.
There's a request for the floor from Pakistan. You have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. My delegation supports the point of order raised by China. Thank you.
I have a request for the floor from Cuba. Thank you, President. I believe that the reminder from the Special Rapporteur this morning was very clear. And at the same time, we also need to bear in mind that the forum should not be used under in any way to deal with separatist issues raised by organizations or persons, as mentioned by the delegate from China. They might even have terrorist intentions that has even been documented. Therefore, we support the statement made by China. Thank you very much. We have a request for the floor from Venezuela. You have the floor. Thank you very much, President. Good morning to everybody. Venezuela supports the contributions of civil society to the mechanisms of this Council on the basis of dialogue and cooperation, which are the fundamental pillars of our work. However, it is completely out of order to have mentions that are not in accordance with the spirit of this space to raise allegations against states in this organization, particularly from NGOs of the type that was trying to bring to this room a message that is not in accordance with what is being discussed in this forum. Therefore, we would ask, President, that you urge speakers to stick to the mandate of this important forum. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Representative of Venezuela. We have a request from the floor from Austria. Ireland first, please.
Mr. President, I'd like to lend my voice to the comments made by my colleague from Switzerland. It's very important in the context of this dialogue that NGOs do have the right to take the floor and that they do have the right to deliver their statements. We therefore respectfully urge you to let the speaker continue with their statement. Thank you.
And now I give the floor to Austria.
Thank you very much, Chair. Very briefly, to second the points made by my Swiss and Irish colleagues, I don't believe that the accreditation is within the competence of individual member states of this forum. So we would like to invite you to let the speaker continue with the statement. Thank you.
We have a request for the floor from Russia. Russia, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chairman. Sir, we have the greatest respect for all participants in the forum. We advocate equal and respectful statements from all participants of the forum. And we think all participants from states, from civil society, should observe certain rules. As we see, for 9 sessions now, every time constructive discussions and dialogue in Council faced the problem of the lack of these rules, which could be observed by all participants in the forum, and this would make our dialogue today a constructive bent. The problem is that there are no such rules in the forum on minority issues, and this is the main reason for all the problems, including the issue raised by the delegation of China. In light of this, we believe that in future the forum cannot function without proper rules and regulations. Since I have the floor, I'd like to ask the special rapporteur, Ms. Ijak Ndiaye, I'd like to ask her to include in the list of recommendations for the sessions of this forum a recommendation on the need to develop rules for the functioning of the forum inter alia on accreditation. We believe that it is precisely such rules and regulations which would enable us in the future to conduct constructive, calm dialogue on the substance, on the issue of minorities in the world and not on issues of procedure. Thank you.
Thank you very much, the representative of Russia. We have a request for the floor from the Egyptian delegation. You have the floor.
Chair, my delegation would like to support the point of order raised by China. Thank you very much.
Thank you. There is a request from the floor from the delegation of Finland.
Thank you, Chair. I just want to add my voice to Switzerland, Ireland and Austria on letting the civil society participants speak. This is a platform for open dialogue, and we have clear rules for NGO participation at the Human Rights Council that we should respect and continue the dialogue and not this rules of procedure debate. Thank you.
Okay.
We have a request for the floor from the delegation of Iran. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson. We would like to support the point of order made by our distinguished colleagues from China and also the points raised by our colleague from Russian mission. Thank you so much.
Indonesia has asked for the floor. You have the floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And my delegation would also like to lend its support to the point of order made by the delegation of China as well as Russia. And while I'm having the floor here, we all know that we welcome the participation of the civil society organizations as well as representatives here during the forum, but we all abide by the rules of procedures under the auspices of the United Nations. So we seek the indulgence as well as the leadership from you, Mr. President, to keep the forum to be proceed in accordance to the rules of the procedures that we have under the UN. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much. The delegation of Bolivia has asked for the floor. You have the floor. Thank you, President. I would like to ask the presidency to strive to ensure that we safeguard the forum through a respect for the supreme principles of the United Nations, and we need to ensure that words do not go beyond these principles, and in this sense we support the motion raised by China, and we affirm that this does not deny the broad participation that we would also support, because we support minorities and broad participation. Thank you, President.
Muy bien. Siendo
very well. As there are no further requests for the floor with regard to this topic, apologies. I can't see it from here, but South Africa has asked for the floor. You have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. From the outset, let me mention that it was not the intention of the South African delegation to take the floor at this stage. However, we slightly worried since yesterday that it appears that this house is not being kept in order. So we want to, Mr. Chair, appeal to you to really keep the house in order, and also appeal to the special rapporteur to assist you to do so. We're also worried about all these applause that are happening in the house. We don't think that it is in line with how we ought to be conducting ourselves in these meetings. So once again, please do keep the house in order. Thank you.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. Obviously, we have to close this debate. It's clear that in my role as chair, I have to try to make a decision here, but I'm going to try to use my common sense as much as possible. First issue, I believe that there are delegations that have said that we might need to introduce some type of criteria before the holding of the forum. This would be related to the rules that should be implemented when taking the floor, particularly with regard to when non-governmental organizations take the floor. This is not something that we can resolve today, nor should we do it today. Therefore, I believe that until we consolidate this proposal to create rules of procedure that the forum secretariat and the special rapporteur would raise, which sets out clearly the rules, we will stick with the current rules and the current elements that we have. Well, the NGO took the floor, followed all of the existing steps in place, and all of the measures that they need to take to ensure that it could take the floor. And I will not take away their right to the floor. We need to be clear that all of the interventions that have been made on this point show that it is clearly a controversial point. It shows that there is tension at the heart of our debate, which is very visible, not only in the statements that have been made, but also the physical aspects that we see in tensions such as this. And I would admit that we are facing a controversial issue, which is as yet unresolved. I will now briefly refer, before I give the floor back to the NGO, which has followed all of the steps to come here today, I want to touch on the issue of applause. I've thought about this an awful lot, and I would like to say that we need also to think not only about what is happening, but we need to think about what really is happening and what has led to it happening. We here are looking at an issue that perhaps in 10 years will be seen as normal, but here we are in a forum in which some people are saying that within the United Nations this is something that is not usually used, because I and I agree, because for many decades I have participated in similar meetings. But we need to ask, what is the meaning of this spontaneous reaction from the people who are participating in this forum today? I don't yet have a socio-anthropological explanation for this. All I can say is what I feel, and what I feel is what, and I've been perceiving is what happens. But perhaps within 10 years, what has happened today will become normal. But there is a lot of, all the pressure falls on the shoulders of the presidency, the chairman's role. And as a result of that, I will give the floor back to the organization that originally asked for the floor, but I would please ask you to bear in mind everything that has been said and that has happened. And I would like to ask that you fully implement full respect to ensure that this forum continues to be a constructive dialogue, because what we have to resolve are the issues facing the daily lives of people. Therefore, we've also said that states that raise this type of issue, please direct themselves to the forum secretariat to be able to find a consensual way to resolve the issue. And therefore, the NGO that had the floor before will have it again. It will have the remainder of its time. But we need to bear in mind everything that has been said up to now. Thank you very much.
As it stands today, the only legal religious practice that remains available for Uyghurs is for those over the age of 18, and only within state-sanctioned mosques. All activities outside this venue may now be considered illegal religious practice. An incredibly broad anti-terror law was also passed in late 2015 that will likely legitimize ongoing rights violations and facilitate future abuses against Uyghurs. Ensuring respect for human rights acts as an antecedent to peace and stability. It should not be a casualty to insecurity, but a remedial force. As a result of these cumulative policies, Uyghurs are increasingly fleeing China in hopes of reaching states where their rights can be adequately respected. Many have been forced to turn to human traffickers as the only viable means to leave the region through Southeast Asia. On the 8th of July 2015, 109 Uyghurs who had been held in an immigration detention facility in Bangkok, Thailand, were illegally and forcibly returned to China in clear violation of the non-refoulement principle underpinning the Refugee Convention. The UNHCR had been given assurances by Thai authorities that those in detention would be safe from persecution, as the group made it plainly clear that they did not want to be deported. Although a delegation was sent to China in order to check on the state of those returned, no official report or statement was ever released concerning the state of the group, and the whereabouts are unknown still today. As it stands, 60 Uyghurs remain in immigration detention facilities near Bangkok, who have been held for nearly 3 years without access to legal remedy. The chance of arbitrary return to China for this group remains very high, considering many cases over the past decade of illegal extradition from many of China's neighbors. The problem then faced by Uyghur asylum seekers today must be approached in terms of root causes, as well as in terms of addressing the problems faced by these groups in situations of humanitarian crisis. We must first understand why it is that members of the Uyghur community would leave to begin with, while also ensuring that those that have already left are protected in transit. Uyghur refugees and asylum seekers must be afforded their rights under international law. Non-refoulement is not a principle that may be cast away in emergency situations, but must be upheld to ensure that most vulnerable groups are protected when they make the difficult choice to leave their homes on account of unbearable repression. We therefore call on the concerned states to allow the 60 remaining Uyghurs in Thailand to move to a third country in the best interest of all those concerned. Only through constructive and continued dialogue can genuine progress be made, and that's what we urge China and all UN member states to enter into as a first step. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now give the floor to Freedom Front Plus. And I would also ask this organization and all of those that will speak after it to do its utmost.
We thank you, Mr. President, for this opportunity. Our submission focuses on the early warning stage of preventing a crisis in South Africa. The Afrikaner and various other minorities, including the Khoisan First Nation, are experiencing increasing pressure from the government that relegates minorities to the tyranny of the majority in all spheres of life. This means that minorities may never have majority representation even within their own institutions. This oppressive system is carefully crafted as an exception to the constitutional equality rule. The government has in effect turned this exception into an overarching rule itself by legislative overreach that surpasses equitable redress. This is evidenced by the creation of a whole spate of racial discrimination legislation, more so than the previous apartheid regime itself. The following are some examples of discrimination, if addressed, that will lead to the avoidance of humanitarian crisis in South Africa. First, no legislative or institutional mechanisms exist whereby minorities can govern their own cultural rights. This is in contravention of the United Nations prerequisites to prevent a humanitarian crisis. Afrikaners are by law and other minorities by practice excluded from the labor and business markets. The imbalance is perpetuated by the fact that the government is still implementing affirmative action in the public service, even though the demographic representation targets have already been met. This is in contravention of the International Convention on Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination. Thirdly, a total of 1,651 farm murders against Afrikaners were committed from 1990 to 2013, and there are still no proper government plans to stop it. Lastly, the ANC government prosecutes hate speech perpetrators one-sidedly, but tolerates senior politicians in parliament that actively propagate genocide against white minorities. For example, the leader of the EFF, the Economic Freedom Fighters political party, that stated categorically in public, "We are not calling for the slaughter of white people, at least for now." So genocide is planned for later by these people, and the government is doing nothing to stop them. Therefore, we, the Freedom Front Plus of South Africa, request this forum on minority issues to share and adopt our concerns about the systemic exclusion and targeting of Afrikaners and other minorities, and recommend a full international investigation in order to pressurize the government to put an end to these racially discriminating measures and to promote minority rights actively in South Africa. And lastly, I would just like to mention to all the states that oppose the NGOs making statements that international determination or self-determination internally and externally is a human right, and they should be accorded those human rights, and they should therefore have the right to speak uninterruptedly in this forum. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. I will now give the floor to the Comitato per il Sentimiento y il Reconocimiento del Popolo Veneto. As I am Argentinian, it is very easy for me to pronounce Italian words. You have the floor.
Good morning, and thank you, Mr. President. I am the President of the Committee for the International Census and Recognition of the Venetian People. In name of Venetian people, I would like to thank you in having given us the possibility to be present at last year's session and the opportunity to be here also this year. Humanitarian crisis, subject of this year's forum, connects our claim for the international recognition of a people. The history, the language, the civilization, the positive institutional and social values, and with them the dignity of Venetian people, continue to be denigrated, removed, mystified, hidden, and looted. This year is the 150th anniversary of the fraudulent plebiscite that on October 1866 signed the annexation of the Venetian people to the Italian reign. Due to this annexation, more than half of our people had to start the diaspora to the rest of the world, escaping from hunger, wars, humiliation and robberies that still today continue to suffer. The Venetian banking system, based on popular banks, fruit of an anthropological federalism defense, has been financially attacked by stealing at least 11 billion euro of private saving, threw into desperation hundreds of thousands of families, and not only, forbidding them also the truth on responsibility. All this violence has a devastating effect and is flowing into a humanitarian crisis. To testify this, we have increasing cases of suicide of young people, fathers and businessmen. We also note our graduates escaping from their territory, mortgaging the future of our society causing a social economical failure. We also have to see our senior citizens beg what necessary to survive. We are very near a civil war, this hidden by mass media hypocrisy. We have already denounced to this meeting intimidation acts, trial, imprisonments and racist methods regarding us caused by legislations and interests that are against Venetians and other people of the Italic peninsula. With the support of mayors of different towns, we started the first step to be recognized as a national minority, following European law standard. We began this chancel for the recognition of the Venetian people and are here today to plead our cause, thanking you all for whatever you will do in the future to help us to be identified as so. Freedom and dignity for Venetian people. God bless San Marco. Viva San Marco. Thank you, Mr. President.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. I now give the floor to the Ogaden Young Women Group. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. The plight of women and children in Ogaden is beyond descriptions. Thousands have suffered gang rape, forceful displacement, arbitrary detention and extreme torture. More than 10,000 women are in detention in Ogaden, and every female detained is a subject to humiliation, rape and torture. Even young women are used to train recruits on how to rape other women, as confirmed by the British freelance reporter Graham Peebles, who have interviewed victims at the Dadaab refugee center in Kenya. Civilians in Ogaden are constantly detained illegally, and women and girls constitute most of the detainees. Many torture survivors in refugee camps in Kenya, after examination, have been found disabled, while others bore deadly scars of torture on their bodies. We call upon the international community, human rights agencies, and the UN to conduct impartial and thorough investigation regarding the rampant rape in Ogaden, perpetrated by the Ethiopian army and its associated new police. We have the same rights as other women in other countries.
There is a request for the floor from Ethiopia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson. It is not my delegation's intention to ask a point of order at this right stage of our discussion. But as it is rightly pointed out in many delegations' remarks throughout the day yesterday and today, Mr. Chairperson, this platform is meant for constructive dialogue. This is not a forum switched to the subject to a politically motivated agenda of some responsible organizations. We respect and support the participation of NGOs in this forum. It is, however, unfortunate that politically motivated organizations linked to affiliated terrorist networks use the forum in the name of NGOs to distort this noble cause of the forum. I request you to guide the speaker not to abuse the forum. I thank you, Mr. Chairperson.
It's simply a brief response to the distinguished delegate from Ethiopia. Well, really this is related to something that happened a short time ago. I know that we can do things with words. Words are not innocent. So if we use terms such as, for example, genocide, during my participation in the CERD, I did look specifically at the term genocide, and there are words that we need to be very clear about, that we need to understand very clearly, even when we talk about terrorism. You'll be well aware that today, nowadays, we see an increasing number of words used on the interpretation of facts that are very controversial and difficult. I'm very grateful that these points of order are being raised, but I think that we need to bear in mind what I said earlier. If this organization has up to now complied with all of the requirements which have allowed it to be here today, we have to give it the floor today. And we need to bear in mind what some of the delegations said, for example, the delegation of Russia, which asked for more defined rule on how and in what way these non-governmental organizations can come to this forum. But today they are here, and we can't resolve this issue today. So I have to continue to give the organization the floor. I would ask you, you and the non-governmental organization, to ensure that the dialogue is effectively as constructive as possible. The non-governmental organization has the floor once again.
Thank you, Mr. President. We have the same rights as women in other countries to which the international community looks with concern, but our case is ignored. When women are caught in conflict, children also suffer. Hundreds of children have been adversely affected by the ongoing war in Ogaden. Many children died, and more were detained with their mothers, and many more are scarred for life due to malnutrition and lack of proper care due to the economic and humanitarian embargo imposed on the civilian population as a collective punishment. We specifically request the recommendation to include strong component for the protection of women and children in conflict areas. Finally, we request the forum to support us for the call for an international investigation in the use of rape as a weapon of war in Ogaden, and to support the resolution of Ogaden conflict through political and peaceful means. Thank you.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much. The Mboro Social and Cultural Development Association now has the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson. One of the main causes of conflict affecting indigenous peoples that leads to humanitarian crisis is the lack of recognition of indigenous peoples' rights, including their land and resource rights. Like many countries in the world, the indigenous peoples in Bangladesh are being driven away from their traditional lands. The conflict situation in Bangladesh is causing the extinction of indigenous peoples and other minority communities, or otherwise threatening their existence as distinct peoples. Most of the cases relating to human rights violation involving the indigenous peoples in Bangladesh were centered on land. The land grabbers used a heinous ploy to sexually and physically violate indigenous women and girls in order to terrorize their community, to unsettle them, and thus create opportunities for them to occupy the lands belonging to indigenous peoples. For example, on 19 June 2015, land greedy ruffians invaded a victim's land in Chittagong district, where 10 women and children were injured. The alarming figures of violence against indigenous women and girls in Bangladesh in the recent past included not a single case of instance to prove that the victim availed justice. Rather, in most cases, the perpetrator got out of bail and skipped punishment due to corruption in the justice system, which often tended to be biased towards the perpetrators. For example, in the case of attack on women leader Bichitra Tirki by land grabbers in August 2015, 14 in Chapainabovgans district, the perpetrators succeeded in obtaining bail by bribing the investigating officer and other concerned officials. Soon after obtaining the bail, the accused continued issuing threats to the victim to withdraw the case or face severe consequences, including the abduction of her daughter, malpractice in the prosecutions and justice system often deprive the victims from getting redress, failure to close the gap between acts of crime and dispensation of justice encourage perpetrators to threaten victims' family and to commit such crime further. In recent decades, thousands of indigenous families were ousted from their own heart and home, and untimely their livelihood and economic backbone were completely broken down. Sexual violence against indigenous women and girls is also a tool universally used to seize lands of indigenous peoples in order to prevent or mitigate violence against indigenous women and girls that leads to conflicts and humanitarian crises. The state governments, including Bangladesh, need to take special measures to recognize traditional land rights of indigenous peoples that would respect the practice of collective rights of community. This arrangement would help to reduce the gross human rights violations, including violence against indigenous women and girls, as most of the violations occur due to the land grabbing and eviction. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much for your statement. I will now give the floor to ARCDH Association for the Defense for People of Azerbaijan. You have the floor.
Monsieur le Président.
Sir, the statement of rights of persons belonging to minorities, national, ethnic, religious, and linguistic minorities, requires elimination of all forms of discrimination against members of minorities and recognition of their legitimacy without any discrimination. Now, minorities are often disproportionately affected by humanitarian crises, national disasters, and man-made disasters, and they are also affected by social and economic crises. For instance, sir, I should like to mention the human disaster ongoing in my region of Azerbaijan in Iran. Urmia Lake, the second largest saltwater lake in the world, has now shrunk by 95%. In addition to the potential damage by sea salt to sustainable agriculture, salt storms cause a health crisis with a great increase of diseases of the skin, with dryness and allergies of the eyes, and lung cancer and high blood pressure in the provinces of East and West Azerbaijan. The 5% of the lake which still survives and the nearly 8 billion tons of salt exposed to the air leaves scant hope for people living in this area. Given this environmental disaster, it's inevitable that 5 million people will have to leave. Therefore, we will witness a humanitarian disaster affecting those who are most vulnerable, especially women and children. They will have to leave their homes and communities in East and West Azerbaijan. Despite the goodwill of the international community and experts who want to save the lives of millions of people in Azerbaijan, Iran, we have seen that for several years, Lake Urmia has become very politicized by the government of Iran. The authorities of Iran have systematically created an obstacle to the use of the budget allocated for the project to save Lake Urmia. And to date, none of the promises of President Rouhani have been kept, although he has made many promises as president. We demand that the state of Iran should stop using the shrinking of Lake Urmia as a tool to exert political pressure, and we demand they assume their responsibilities and take urgent environmental and humanitarian measures which are required. We believe that respect for minorities is a way of preventing or mitigating the impact of the humanitarian crisis. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your statement. I now give the floor to Information Group on Crimes Against the Person. You have the floor.
Good morning. I'm Maxim Valkov, Information Group on Crimes Against the Person. Over the last 2 years, our group has been following the human rights situation on the territory of Ukraine. Today, I'd like to point out the situation with internally displaced, temporarily displaced persons in Ukraine. During the anti-terrorist operation, as it was called, millions of people had to leave their homes and move to other places. Some of them moved to the Russian Federation, but most preferred to remain on the territory of Ukraine and move to other places in Ukraine. Unfortunately, we see today that the government of Ukraine is not able to manage the crisis with these temporarily displaced persons. There aren't even exact statistics as to how many people are living, how many temporary displaced persons are now in the territory of the Ukraine. The figures which have been given vary from about nearly 2 million people to just over 700,000. And therefore, the allocations of financing are based on these very different estimates to assist these people. To illustrate the situation, I can tell you about the situation with the provision of housing. Under Ukrainian legislation, temporarily displaced persons must be provided with housing. Unfortunately, today, over 60% of temporarily displaced persons have to live with their families, and over 30% have to rent housing and pay themselves. Only about 7% of temporarily displaced persons have obtained from the government of Ukraine temporary housing. Moreover, allocation of material assistance. Unfortunately, today, the amount of material assistance for a four-person family is 3,000 to 4,000 hryvnia, which is not enough even for subsistence level existence, let alone renting housing. Then we have the problem of employment, problems of medicine. And the most important thing is that the crisis of displaced persons is being supported by the Ukrainian media, who are calling them separatists, and this is going to aggravate the humanitarian crisis in Ukraine. Thank you.
Thank you for your statement. I now give the floor to the Balochistan Human Rights Group.
Muchas gracias, señor presidente.
Thank you, Chairman.
My name is Munira Shirani and I represent Balochistan Human Rights Group. Balochistan is rich in natural resources such as gas and coal. But in reality, the Baloch people live in the poorest and least developed region of Iran. The economic crisis which Iran is facing is five times more extreme in Balochistan. The Baloch, an ethnic minority in Iran with its own culture and language, are deprived of equal education, economic as well as political participation. Attempts in recent years to set up poetry nights, cultural events, newsletters in Baluchi have all met severe punishment, as the organizers have been incarcerated and in some cases executed, all of this in the name of national security. Baluch children do not have a connection to their language or history. All traits of Balochistan are being erased. A strong cultural cleansing campaign is taking place to eradicate their identity. Women in Iran, due to their gender, are not equal in law. Baluch women suffer multiple and intersecting forms of discrimination. Baluch women are discriminated based on their ethnicity, Baluch, religion, Sunni, language, Baluchi, and consequently not given the opportunity to participate in decisions affecting them. In recent years, executions of prisoners have risen to the point that last year more than 900 prisoners were executed in Iran. Just this year, 39 Baluch male prisoners have been executed. There are too many cases of the death sentence being carried out without legal representation, forced confession, and even cases where the courts have not followed the protocol of the legal system in the country. These executions, often based on juvenile arrest, torture, and unfair or non-existing trials show total contempt for the rule of law. Whole male populations in a village in Balochistan have been executed following Iran's war on drugs. This has a devastating effect on the Baloch community, as families are losing their breadwinners. The protection of Baloch, both physically and as a minority group, should be a priority for the state. With the lack of media coverage, the Baloch are forgotten, as the state can ignore the security and the rights of the Baloch. Balochistan human rights groups recommend that pressure is put on the state to follow legal procedure and guarantee that all prisoners have a fair trial and access to the judicial system, that the UN investigates death penalty procedures in Iran, that the Special Rapporteur on Minority Rights investigates in the situation of the Baloch community in Iran. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your statement. I now give the floor to the AWAS Human Rights Organization, which is the last organization that I have on the list at the moment.
Mr. President, my name is Shema Silavi from AWAS Human Rights Organization. I'm speaking on behalf of the Ahwazi Arab ethnic minority. Residing mainly in the southwest of Iran, the Ahwazi Arab are one of Iran's most disadvantaged and most prosecuted ethnic group. Arabs estimated to be between 5 to 7 million, or about 10% of the population of Iran, who live in the southwestern regions of Iran, in the province of Khuzestan, or also called by its indigenous name, Iqlim al-Ahwaz, or Arabistan. Ahwazis constitute an indigenous, ethnic, national, and linguistic minority in Iran. Historically, this indigenous Arab community has been marginalized, excluded, and discriminated.
Iran has asked for the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson. It is a principal criteria that any participant in the UN fora should use the recognized reference to the geographical names and regions of the UN members and to observe the territorial integrity and sovereignty of states. Hence, please remind the speaker to respect this issue and to refrain from using the fabricated names regarding the Iranian territories. Thank you, Mr. Chairperson.
Thank you very much. We will continue asking what we've been asking all along. This is a dialogue. We need to bear in mind and keep in mind an understanding that we need to have a deep discussion here. I would ask the representative of the NGO to continue with their statement and adhere to the principles that intensify the debate in this forum. You have the floor.
Although this province accounts for up to 90% of Iran's all GDP, the towns and cities populated by the Ahwazi Arabs in Khuzestan province continue to bear the scar of the Iran-Iraq War of the 1980s, where many Ahwazis, including my relatives, have been killed. During the Iran-Iraq War, the geographic location of Khuzestan caused the province to suffer a great deal of environmental damages, the effect of which are beginning to affect the health of the population. Residents of the war-torn Arab cities of Khafajiyeh, Falahiyeh, Shadegan, and Susangir suffer from unusually high rate of skin, heart, and kidney diseases due to continued storage and use of chemical and biological materials and other related pollutants remaining from the war. Ahwazi Arab farmlands are heavily contaminated with industrial pollutants and the detritus of war, leading to serious birth defects as well as skin and respiratory diseases. The government has not taken any action to remedy the situation. According to the Human Rights Watch report, millions of landmines remaining from the Iran-Iraqi war in the province of Khuzestan killed and maimed indigenous inhabitants of and in southwestern areas every day, most of which are girls and boys who work in the fields. In the case of any natural disaster, also, the Iranian authority do not provide any support or aid to the affected indigenous citizens and farmers. The flood that hit the Ahvaz region earlier this year and devastated farms and homes have caused 10.5 trillion Iranian rials of damage, according to the latest estimates. Ahvazi farmers complain that only 10% of the funds dedicated to drainage project over 550 hectare region were actually spent. That means the farmers had to foot the bill for the destruction of their homes and farms as a result of maladministration and corruption. As after 30 years, we have not been provided any answer to why and for what reason we are fighting to hold on our national identity, culture and language, while the state has excluded us from the Iranian landscape politically, economically and socially. And if you think that what I'm stating here is hyperbole or exaggeration, please look at the reports that the Iranians have supported, these blue booklets, in where every city and every province is detailed according to the ethnicity and religion. But the only city and the only province that is not stated is Ahvaz and the province of Khuzestan. No mention of Arabs at all. And I think the report confirms my statement. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your statement. And I will now give the floor to Ethiopia, which is the last speaker on the list on this item. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Chairperson, my request is the right of reply, and the Ethiopian federal system is unreserved. It is not my intention, of course, to take this reply. The Ethiopian federal system is unreserved in empowering ethnic, linguistic, and religious minorities as a very foundation of the political structure based on the principle of equality of all nations and nationalities. However, it is a worry that there is no shadow of doubt that this forum is hijacked by terrorist organization to the wrong direction. It is being used as other alternative field of struggle to meet their target of the hidden agenda. Ethiopia is proud of dismantling terrorist organization in the region, in our region, including in Ugadian. Some so-called NGOs like Ugadian People's Organization and Ugadian Women Organization are observed not respecting the territorial integrity and the sovereignty of the member country. The reality is that the Somali National Regional State is one of the strongest and stable self-administered national regional state in Ethiopia. Somali language is the official language of the regional state. The regional state meets the theme of this forum by hosting the highest number of refugees, among those 800,000 refugees hosted in Ethiopia from crisis-stricken neighboring countries. Therefore, the allegation made by these NGOs is baseless and doesn't reflect factors in the ground. Thank you, Mr. Chairperson.
Thank you very much. Your statement. And with that, we close the list of speakers for this item. We shall now begin our discussion and conversation under item 4 of our agenda, entitled Protecting Minority Rights During Humanitarian Crises. I would like to remind those participants, that the list for item 5 is closed. We will now begin our discussions on item 4 of the agenda. And it is my pleasure to welcome the following panelists: Ms. Michelle Klein-Solomon, director of the Migrants in Crisis Initiative, MICIC, from the International Migration Organization, IOM. Dr. Shaloka Bayani, Professor of International Law, London School of Economics, and former Special Rapporteur on the Human Rights of Internally Displaced People. Ms. Laura Ronkainen, Field Support Manager, Joint Internally Displaced Persons Profiling Services, JIPS. And Dr. Farah Miller, Minority Rights Expert. All those interested in the topic are invited to participate. And the most important thing for us is to bear in mind best practices and the best way to have a positive impact on the challenge that we are facing currently. Once again, I have a recommendation, which is based on the way that we think that we should participate in a dialogue. It's obvious that moderation is one way, and also thinking about the type of language we use is another way. We need to remember that it has an extraordinary impact. We should not simply raise challenges for other people, but to ourselves. We are not only part of the solution, but sometimes part of the problem itself. I will now give the floor to Ms. Michelle Klein-Solomon. And she has 7 minutes for her statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson, Madam Special Rapporteur, the Secretariat, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. It is truly a pleasure and honor to be here with you today to have an opportunity to address the question of protection of minority rights in the context of humanitarian crises. Chairperson introduced me. I've recently served as the director of the Secretariat of the Migrants in Countries in Crisis Initiative, which was a state-led initiative, but engaged international organizations, civil society organizations, private sector, to really look at the risks and vulnerabilities that migrants experience when crises occur, and to look at what can be done to reduce vulnerability, enhance protection, and promote solutions. The reason this initiative is relevant to our discussion today is that in many respects, migrants face similar challenges to ethnic, religious, and other minorities, and particularly the opportunity to look at three phases of a crisis: pre-crisis preparedness, actual crisis response, and post-crisis reconstruction and recovery in a way that ensures the inclusion of the risks, the vulnerabilities, the particularities of migrant populations, I believe, is directly analogous to the discussions that you are having here today. The reasons that the states and the Migrants and Countries in Crisis Initiative was led by the governments of the Philippines and the U.S., with the participation of a working group with six other governments, the several international organizations, several civil society organizations, and the private sector, because they saw that at this point in the world, much like across the world, that no country is immune to disasters, to natural disaster or conflict in some or part or whole of the country, and at the same time, often migrants or other forms of minority populations are not accounted for in disaster response planning. And while nationals, of course, and majority populations will be affected by crisis situations, minorities, like migrants, will experience additional barriers and vulnerabilities because of their unique characteristics. In the case of migrants, which is also the case with many minority communities, they may face barriers because they don't speak the same language. They may face barriers because of culture and cultural comfort with the authorities and the willingness to come forward and identify themselves in a crisis situation. Their legal status may create additional barriers to coming forward for protection and assistance. And as I said, most importantly, they're often simply not accounted for in disaster risk reduction and response mechanisms, and their particular vulnerabilities, needs, and barriers to access for protection are the kinds of things that motivated the need for this initiative. Many of you will remember the crisis in Libya in 2011, which really shined the world's attention on the fact that there were large migrant populations during that civil conflict. Nearly 2 million migrant workers were displaced as a result, and because of the conflict, they did not have access to the normal means of protection, including of their own governments through their consulates. But of course, crises are not limited to conflict affecting minorities and migrants, but natural disasters always, also. And while the vulnerabilities may be of a different character, there are some that are quite the same. As a result, we undertook a very broad and inclusive set of consultations, 6 regional consultations around the world, inclusive consultations led by governments, but with also the participation of civil society organizations, the private sector, first responders, relevant international organizations, with a view toward identifying good practices and local mechanisms and responses that could be utilized potentially and learned from in other regions of the world, or even in the same region, and expanded to be adopted by others. The outcome, and I'll turn to this very quickly, was a series of principles, core principles, obviously saving lives first, ensuring non-discriminatory access to protection and assistance, providing targeted measures to overcome barriers, some key core principles, 10, as well as practices, guidelines that are addressed to the pre-crisis preparedness phase, to the actual emergency phase, and to the post-crisis response and reconstruction phase, much like what is being proposed here for minority populations. And we underpinned those principles and guidelines with effective practices that were garnered from states and from civil society, international organizations, and very importantly from the private sector around the world, and created a repository with more than 300 good practices, with the idea that by learning from the ground up, we could share good responses and do a better job collectively at protection and assistance. I won't go into details now in the interest of time. I'm happy to share with you and make available to you those guidelines, as well as particularly the online repository of practices, because of course there are some minority populations that are also migrant populations, and in particular I'm thinking here of pastoralist and nomadic populations, but of course other ethnic minorities and religious minorities. So I do believe there are things that can be imported from the work that we did with respect to migrants that are of direct relevance to your work here, and would encourage in thinking about solutions, an inclusive approach that brings in civil society, private sector, civil protection actors, and more. Thank you very much for your time.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Michelle Klein-Solomon, for your presentation. I will now give the floor to Dr. Shailoka Bayani so that she can use her 7 minutes to give her statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. At the outset, may I express my appreciation to the Special Rapporteur on Minority Issues and the Forum for extending an invitation for me to participate in this forum. In the 7 minutes available, I wish to address the correlation between issues of minorities and displacement, and the perspective comes from my time as mandate holder on the human rights of internally displaced persons, although I very much speak as an academic at this point in time. Most of the 65 million of the world's displaced populations in humanitarian situations today actually are persons belonging to minorities. So there's a clear correlation between the phenomenon of displacement and the forcible displacement of minorities to erode their distinct identity and also to remove them from their geographical location. The basis of this correlation lies in statehood. The interests of states and minorities are not diametrically opposed, although their relationship remains an uneasy one in most cases. Minority issues are central to statehood. State formation processes or creation often leads to the incorporation of populations of minorities as communities with a distinct identity, usually in specific geographical locations. Minorities are therefore part of the territorial sovereignty of states, but the sovereignty of states connotes a primary responsibility for protecting all those within their territories and jurisdiction, including minorities and internally displaced persons. Why protection? The protection is called for to respect and ensure the rights of minorities because of their distinct identity and vulnerability on the one hand, and to safeguard sovereignty and territorial integrity on the other hand. But I also wish to make the proposition that the displacement of minorities is an historical phenomenon. We saw population exchanges in the 1920s. We then saw forcible population transfers in the 1940s. And we have seen thereafter in the 1990s, of course, active removal, ethnic cleansing of minorities in the Caucasus, in the Balkans, and elsewhere in the world. And this experience does point out to the way in which there is a similarity between minorities and displacement. The displacement system standards prohibits the displacement of minorities in the first instance in order to protect their characteristics and geographical location. Ethnic cleansing is also prohibited quite clearly because of the fact that this is an extreme form of discrimination against minorities. What then has been the experience of my mandate in the context of displacement and minorities? First is marginalization. Persons belonging to minorities that I met in situations of displacement were often amongst the poorest, and many of them had experienced forms of marginalization prior to displacement. Displacement exacerbated their situation. They also lacked representation in the political or other state bodies. They lacked documentation. As a result of that, many of them became stateless, or there was a risk to statelessness, as we heard yesterday, and also their rights as citizens are not fully respected. And the system of displacement and protection ensures that these rights are restored to minorities as internally displaced persons. There are also other factors related to the physical safety and security of displaced minorities. And here I think the system of protection needs to be sensitive to the fact that it's minorities involved, their characteristics have to be protected, and also their livelihood issues, the type of food that is available to them must be culturally sensitive. Issues of health, reproductive health care for women must also be quite sensitive to the fact that minorities need special protection. I also found that frequently issues of housing, land and property rights affected minorities disproportionately than other IDPs. Their return was discouraged. The original causes of displacement very much influenced the way in which certain authorities at the municipal level treated minorities and obstructed their return. And again, there are many examples in the paper that I've given in relation to the schedule that is there. I found that there were specific challenges facing women and children from displaced minorities' families, and I think the most characteristic of these that has been mentioned is that of the Yazidi women, and also Yazidis in particular. And I found that Yazidis were targeted by Daesh largely because of their identity, but also because of their specific geographical location in the design of Daesh to establish a state from Iraq to Syria. And the Yazidis were seen as an obstacle to this particular design. I also found that most of the Christians in Iraq and their whole culture was affected in the context of displacement. But I think one of the most important things that's important and significant is actually the issue of data. We need more data, we need more investigation to look at this correlation, and I think that this is something that my colleague Laura will speak about coming from the perspective of GIBS. If I just conclude with a synopsis of some of the things that I found when I was on mission to Serbia and Kosovo, clearly the situation of the Roma, Ashkali, Egyptians and Serbs as respective minorities was evident. My missions to Sri Lanka also indicated the displacement of Tamils and Muslims during the conflict, and I'm sure that, again, we'll have a more perspective on this issue. The mission to Ukraine also indicated that the IDPs from the Crimea, including ethnic Ukrainians, Crimean Tatars, ethnic Russians as well, and other members of ethnic and religious groups. I have mentioned the mission to Iraq already in this context, and may I propose to end at this point, Mr. Chair. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair Lockerbioni, for your statement. I now give the floor to Ms. Laura Ronkainen. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, Madam Special Rapporteur, ladies and gentlemen, the need to take into consideration the specific situations of minorities in humanitarian crisis is a fact, and already stated many times on this forum. Minority groups often face intersectional vulnerabilities that can enforce the negative impacts of crisis on them, restrict their access or exclude them from assistance, and hinder the process of recovery. At the same time, humanitarian actors, faced with more and more dire needs and limited resources, aim to target their assistance to the most vulnerable. Standardized vulnerability criteria that assume same vulnerabilities are cross-cutting from context to context often overlook the specific vulnerabilities that minority groups may face and that are further exacerbated by conflict or disaster. Fully understanding the diverse characteristics of populations affected by a crisis is crucial for humanitarian response to be effective in the immediate crisis, as well as for inclusive recovery and peace-building processes. I represent the Joint IDP Profiling Service, an interagency service that supports governments, humanitarian and development actors on profiling, that is, collaborative data collection and analysis in displacement situations, to inform evidence-based response. GIBS is honoured to be part of the panel today to discuss these important issues. Although, when preparing for this presentation, we also realised how scarce concrete good practice on obtaining disaggregated data on minorities in humanitarian situations is. This data gap exists because actors often do not think about this need amidst the humanitarian crisis, and consequently, data systems are not sensitive enough to capture minorities. Secondly, data gaps also exist because this is not an easy topic to collect data on. For example, when supporting displacement profiling exercises to inform national responses, strategy or policy development processes in different displacement contexts, it is almost invariably recognized that understanding the linkages of displacement and different diversity characteristics, such as clan, religion, or ethnicity, are crucial for supporting comprehensive durable solutions to displacement. However, explicitly and adequately collecting data on these characteristics is almost always avoided, in order not to further aggravate existing tensions or not to discourage certain stakeholders or minority groups themselves from taking part in the process. And thirdly, even if capturing data on minorities is recognized as a priority, designing appropriate methodologies for this is often a challenge due to incomplete pre-existing information on them, for example, in pre-crisis statistics. Nonetheless, GIPS is convinced that improving the practice of collecting and analyzing data in a way that captures minority populations' distinct situations is at the core of overcoming humanitarian challenges, finding durable solutions to displacement, and building and sustaining peace. Profiling as a process has a lot of potential to address the challenge of providing this type of evidence. It is not a standard methodology, but a mixture of different data collection tools aiming to capture both statistical and narrative data. It aims to provide a comprehensive profile of the populations of concern, disaggregated by age, sex, and diversity, complemented by thematic analysis and qualitative data that can highlight diverse perspectives also within minority groups. But as much as profiling is about developing the most suitable technical tools and methodologies for each context, it is also about the process through which it is carried out. Through a collaborative approach that involves relevant government, humanitarian, and development actors, profiling aims to build consensus around the results from the start. Through a continuous dialogue by different partners from the development of objectives and methodologies to analysis and formulation of joint recommendations, the aim is to make sure that sensitive issues are explicitly discussed from the start and that data that is collected will be accepted and used. In GIPS's experience, this type of dialogue can help make important advances on political issues through technical solutions. Through a combination of different methods, profiling aims to give a voice to various groups affected by a humanitarian crisis and aims to move away from generalized assumptions of people's vulnerabilities, needs, strengths, and priorities. In this way, it can also be used to complement assessments and other data collection that is used to inform immediate programmatic responses by including minority populations' concerns and assessing the effectiveness and impacts of humanitarian assistance on different groups. Finally, profiling aims to establish a two-way communication with communities by presenting findings and conclusions to them and receiving feedback and suggestions. This validation can also help highlight the distinct concerns of minorities, even when they may not have been adequately represented in the initial methodology. A profiling process, just like any data collection process, should always include this type of an accountability mechanism. However, unfortunately, it is rarely prioritized. To conclude, it is easy to justify why data and analysis on minorities in situations of humanitarian crisis is needed. However, it is also important to consider how this is done and for what purpose. Any data collection in humanitarian contexts should result in actionable information for improved protection and assistance for the populations concerned. Thus, people also have the right to express their humanitarian needs and access assistance mechanisms without identifying themselves as members of a minority group. Data collection systems must be implemented in a way that ensures that people of different backgrounds, including minorities, have the opportunity to voice their concerns and access assistance on the basis of need without discrimination. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ms. Ronkainen. Your statement? I now give the floor to Dr. Farah Miller. You have 7 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. President. Let me start by thanking the Special Rapporteur for her invitation and for her colleagues at the OHCHR for enabling my visit here. My presentation will primarily draw from my experience having researched and worked on Sri Lanka during a humanitarian crisis in early 2009 at the end of the country's three-decade armed conflict between the Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam, who were fighting government forces for a separate homeland for ethnic minority Tamils. Tamils in Sri Lanka are the largest minority of about 18%. During the course of the conflict, minorities have faced other humanitarian crises, including the forcible eviction of the entire Muslim population from the north of Sri Lanka by Tamil militants in 1990. Muslims form about 8 to 9% of the country's population. And of course, after the South Asian tsunami in 2004, many minorities were affected. I want to focus my presentation on human rights protection of minorities in conflict-induced humanitarian crises. When a humanitarian crisis is caused by targeted attacks on a minority population, or when the rights of minorities are violated during a humanitarian crisis, what protection exists for them? In increasingly securitized environments where minorities are frequently portrayed as the other and seen as terrorists or the enemy, how can their rights be protected? It is not uncommon during a crisis for special security laws to be imposed, superseding national laws and used by the state authorities to target rights of minorities. Civil space also becomes limited. Minority activists come under attack. They are threatened, intimidated, referred to as traitors and agents of terror groups, and thereby delegitimized. In the last stages of the Sri Lankan armed conflict, up to 300,000 civilians were trapped in fighting, targeted in shell and bomb attacks by the Sri Lankan military and shot dead by militants as they tried to escape. The government of Sri Lanka denied the population figures, claiming only 75,000 people were caught up in fighting, limiting food and medical aid, leaving thousands starving and without medical support. I cannot stress more the importance of the draft recommendation of this forum on maintaining census statistics which are ethnically disaggregated. And I may add that these statistics should be up to date and made publicly available at all times. This humanitarian crisis in Sri Lanka was specifically caused by the actions of the then government, which pursued a military strategy to eliminate the Tamil militants, showing little concern to the civilian population. It is questionable whether a humanitarian crisis of that magnitude would ever have occurred if the 300,000 people trapped in the fighting were from the majority community. Yet over and over again, as in Sri Lanka, we see the specific minority dimension in conflict-induced humanitarian crises across the world ignored, undermined, or denied. In Sri Lanka, additionally, a human rights crisis was enveloped in a humanitarian crisis, as survivors in displaced camps were targeted for extrajudicial killings, enforced disappearances, torture, arbitrary arrest, detention, sexual violence, and rape. However, even in situations where a humanitarian crisis affects a larger population, minorities could be specifically targeted for human rights violations. The nature of a humanitarian crisis, the acute difficulties people face, and the urgency with which agencies have to respond can at times eclipse human rights protection. This is not to say that humanitarian agencies and organizations don't exert their full protection mandate, but it is not uncommon that it is deprioritized. Minority rights protection subsequently then becomes negligible. In 2012, the UN released a very good internal review of their failures in Sri Lanka, where it admitted, amongst other things, that it was not very accurate in its claims on civilian population figures that were affected and trapped in the fighting. But even in this review, it did not identify the particular minority dimension to the crisis. When minorities are affected by a crisis, the effect it has on them, the targeted nature of the violations, must be explicitly identified by all actors, especially the United Nations, international agencies responding to the crisis. The UN Security Council, UN mechanisms must not turn a blind eye when a crisis hits minorities. As called for in the draft recommendation, minorities need to be effectively involved and participating in decision-making at all levels of responding to the crisis. I would argue that this is not enough. In addition, governments and international agencies need to adopt a minority rights approach to responding to a crisis. In Sri Lanka, for instance, the UNHCR and some other agencies, when dealing with the crisis, came up with two terms as new IDPs and old IDPs. The latter refers to the old IDPs referred to Muslims and those who were displaced during the conflict, and new IDPs were those who were displaced in the immediate situation. This differentiation caused injustice and continues to raise tensions amongst groups. A minority rights approach would have avoided these problems. Such an approach must also recognize the multiple and intersectional discrimination in a humanitarian crisis. UN reports in Sri Lanka have recorded evidence of sexual violence, including rape and torture perpetrated during the humanitarian crisis by the Sri Lankan military on Tamil women, especially former combatants. the dehumanizing nature of the torture and violations against women was intrinsically linked to their ethnic and gender identity as Tamil women. Women will also be disproportionately affected in a crisis. Women have told me of great risks they took to queue to get food for their children, even in the knowledge that such spaces were targeted for attacks. Tamil and Muslim women I have interviewed have told me that they regrettably had to marry their daughters at a very young age as a means of protection. I have found that domestic violence rates are high for many of these women who had early marriages. Minority groups also face cultural and religious rights violations in humanitarian crises that go amiss. Muslim women I have interviewed spoke of the great difficulty they faced in displaced camps to maintain their socio-cultural norms, including specific forms of segregation and dress code. They also had difficulties maintaining their mourning rituals and having to access food relief and other aid. Tamil women also discussed the trauma they suffered, unable to perform certain important religious and cultural rituals after the death of their loved ones. Denial of access to places of religious worship can also affect healing. These limitations have traumatic long-term effects. The effect of a humanitarian crisis on minority populations don't end with the crisis. In fact, it can get exacerbated or entrenched in the years to come. The new government of Sri Lanka has committed to a challenging and ambitious transitional justice program, but mental, emotional, and physical wounds faced by minorities are deep, as is their distrust in the government, and the majority population of Sri Lanka are oblivious to this. I now live in the conflict-affected parts of Sri Lanka, and I can see the long-standing effects of the crisis on the civilian population. They range from militarized societies, increase in gender-based violence, to acute trauma and alcohol and drug addiction problems. Let me end by saying that minorities are affected in varying and complex ways in a crisis, and it is critical that these are all known, understood, redressed through a holistic solution that at its heart respects minority rights. Thank you.
Muchas gracias, señora.
Thank you very much, Ms. Miller, for your statement. And this brings us on to the stage that we call the interactive dialogue. I just want to take 30 seconds to say that contemporary anthropology actually really calls this conversation. And if it is a conversation, every conversation opens horizons rather than closing them. So let's try as much as possible, now we are beginning this conversation and our interactive dialogue, to open our horizons. In the list that I have before me, the first request for the floor is from the distinguished delegation of Austria.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Let me start by congratulating you on your election as the chair of the 9th session of the Forum on Minority Issues, and to the special rapporteur, my congratulations for her important work she has done in preparation of this forum. Once again, this forum allows us to hear the voice of minorities from all over the world on the important topic of minorities in situation of humanitarian crisis, and provides us with an essential opportunity for sharing best practices and promoting mutual understanding of minority issues. The forum's draft recommendations underline the primary responsibility of the state to contribute continually to building resilient and prepared minority communities able to actively respond when crises arise, and if and when a crisis occurs, to provide timely appropriate assistance that is relevant to minorities' communities' specific needs. In many cases, only the minority communities themselves will be able to assess which protection measures are likely genuinely to improve security and which risk making the situation worse. Therefore, the establishment of dedicated institutions to take the lead in mainstreaming attentions to minorities and in monitoring their situation, as well as the participation of minorities themselves at the political level, is essential in our view. In the main strategic document on Austria's humanitarian assistance, the 3-year program on Austrian development policy, we have put a specific focus on the inclusion of vulnerable groups throughout the whole project cycle. We also have made commitments at the World Humanitarian Summit to empower local humanitarian action as well as resilience building. At the international level, UN institutions, funds, programs and organizations must be prepared to be able to actively contribute to the task of protecting minorities in humanitarian crises. In this context, we should explore further the possibility of a more efficient mainstreaming of minority issues into all bodies of the United Nations. We welcome the initiative that the Special Rapporteur has taken in this regard, such as the organization of the recent consultative session in New York, and encourage her warmly to continue contributing to a deeper integration of minority issues also in peace and security agenda of the United Nations. We hope that our discussion during the 2 days would also be the starting point for ECOSOC to consider the specific situation of minorities during its humanitarian segment, and that this forum will be able to make a concrete recommendation to ECOSOC in including the specific needs and abilities of minorities in its discussions of coordinated responses to humanitarian crises. In closing, let me reiterate once again our conviction that diversity and pluralism pose no risk to our society, but a source of development, progress and peace. There may be many different ways in addressing the risks that minorities face in humanitarian crisis, but irrespectively of national context, they all should have a common objective, the promotion and protection of persons belonging to minorities. Austria will continue its strong engagement in this direction, and we are confident that the ideas and recommendations of this year's forum will be a good basis for further progress. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair.
Thank you to the distinguished representative of Austria. I now give the floor to Minority Rights Group Europe.
Dear Mr. Chairperson, Minority Rights Group Europe would like to draw the forum's attention to the situation of members of the Roma community in Ukraine, who have been displaced since 2014 as a result of the conflict in Crimea and eastern Ukraine. Roma in Ukraine comprise a population of around 40,000. According to the last census, however, estimates from the Council of Europe place the figure at closer to 400,000. The challenges facing Roma in Ukraine are significant and include high unemployment, lack of access to good quality education, housing, and cases of mistreatment by police authorities. These issues are not unique to Roma in Ukraine, but affect Roma, Europe's largest minority across the continent. The common issue of lack of civil registration and personal ID documents leave many Roma unable to access welfare, employment, obtain property rights and access to urgent medical services. In the context of Ukraine, Roma without civil registration and ID documents have not been able to obtain essential humanitarian assistance. Increasingly, reports show many Roma are as a result being forced to return to their homes in eastern Ukraine despite ongoing instability, lack of restitution of property and evidence of further violence and discrimination. The situation in Ukraine highlights both the specific added vulnerability of Roma in situations of humanitarian crisis and in general the vulnerability of minorities who lack access to ID documents. As evidence shows, minorities are more likely to lack personal ID than other groups. In situations of humanitarian crisis where people are displaced, the lack of ID can further lead to denial of citizenship and effective statelessness. MRGE therefore supports the adoption of Recommendation 23, Article O, which would guarantee the issuance and renewal of documentation without discrimination. However, we believe non-discrimination by itself is not a sufficient means to address the situation of minorities such as Roma. Measures need to be adopted which address urgency, are proactive, and specific to the context, culture, and location of minorities. With regards to Ukraine, we commend the adoption of the government's strategy on the protection and integration of Roma in Ukraine until 2020 and the National Action Plan on Roma Inclusion. However, more specific measures supported by adequate funding and capacity are required to address the critical needs of Roma IDPs. In 2015, the OSCE contact point for Roma and Sinti provided detailed and practical guidelines on access to ID and civil registration by Roma in Ukraine. We believe these guidelines provide the basis for a concrete action plan to be adopted by Ukraine to support the work of humanitarian agencies. Thank you, Mr. Chairperson.
Thank you very much for your statement. I now give the floor to Association Solidarité Internationale pour la Paix. You have the floor.
No veo que alguien se haga presente.
I don't see anyone from the Association Solidarité Internationale pour la Paix in the room. So I give the floor to the next speaker, which is the distinguished representative of Finland.
Thank you, Chair. I wish to thank the panelists for their interventions. Finland stresses the recognition, prevention and eradication of discrimination on multiple grounds. We support bringing up in decision-making the perspective of women, children, young people, persons with disabilities, indigenous peoples, as well as minorities. The UN Declaration on the Rights of Persons Belonging to National, Ethnic, Religious and Linguistic Minorities reconfirms the obligation of states to ensure that persons belonging to minorities may exercise fully and effectively all human rights without any discrimination. It also underlines the right to participate fully in society. Fulfilling non-discrimination and participation contributes towards vibrant, peaceful and just societies. These obligations of states also apply in situations of crisis. We therefore warmly welcome the draft recommendations on promoting a minority rights-based approach during crises. We wish to particularly highlight and welcome draft recommendation 23D to states on ensuring that protection measures are participatory, non-discriminatory and sensitive to the specific needs of minorities. We warmly also support draft recommendation 25G addressed to the UN and humanitarian and development actors and stating that particular attention should be given to minority persons who may be subjected to multiple and intersecting forms of discrimination in situations of crisis, including unaccompanied children, women, persons with disabilities, older persons, and lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender persons. They should also be prepared to intervene on behalf of minority and indigenous refugees who experience protection problems because they lack identity document or are stateless. We believe that recommendation 25G should be explicitly also be addressed to states apart from the UN and humanitarian actors. In this context, I wish to highlight that Finland is fully committed to the Charter on Inclusion of Persons with Disabilities into Humanitarian Action adopted in Istanbul this year. We would like to call upon all stakeholders to endorse the Charter. The Charter applies to all persons with disabilities, including those that belong to minorities. The potential of this Charter should be fully used also for the purposes of protecting and empowering those persons that are at the same time at risk to be marginalized for their belonging to a minority and due to disability. In this work, it's of particular importance to be gender sensitive. It's time to correct the neglect of these persons, and this must be done by ensuring that their specific needs are met and recognizing their leadership and capacity to participate in decision making, also in humanitarian action. I thank you.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you for your statement. I will now give the floor to the Kurdish Committee for Human Rights in Syria.
Mr. Chair, I would like to thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak to you about the Kurdish people, which is the majority indigenous people in its homeland, Kurdistan, but has been turned into what is called today a minority because of international policies and partitionings, including the Sykes-Picot Agreement of 1916. My name is Suleiman Ismail. I and my colleagues in the Kurdish Committee for Human Rights in Syria speak on behalf of my colleagues. We, the Kurdish people, continue to live on our historic land. Our people is distributed among four states, Syria, Iraq, Iran, and Turkey. Our suffering is equal in four countries. They have equally repressive and inhuman policies in these four countries against us. We are excluded equally in all four countries. The Human Rights Council is the top UN human rights body. And we, as a civil society organization, turn to you, as we have always knocked on the doors of all human rights organizations. Mr. Chair, I will not talk about the policy of executions against Kurds in Iran. I will not talk about our towns and villages burnt down and our political leaders arrested in Turkey. I will not talk about the boycott that we are faced with or the fact that we are deprived of our rightful share in central government in Iraq, because time is short. I would just like to talk about the suffering of the Kurdish people in western Kurdistan annexed by Syria. Successive governments in Syria since independence have not respected international agreements, whether they be binding or not, from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights to all other instruments until this moment where the representative of the Syrian government sits in this town. I will not talk about the gross violations against Syrians in general and Kurds in Syria in particular, which are tantamount to crimes against humanity, as documented by the reports of the commissions of inquiry set up by the Human Rights Council since the 22nd of August of 2011. I would like respectfully to ask you, as representatives of the Human Rights Council, of the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, as the Forum on Minority Issues, and I ask the Special Rapporteur on Minorities, has the Syrian government, since the Ba'ath Party took power, ever responded seriously to your resolutions on the Syrian government practices against the Kurdish people? Has the Syrian government complied with any Human Rights Council resolutions adopted on Syria since 2011? What is the solution as we find this regime continues its crimes against human rights? We would like to recommend to open a local UN office in Qamishli in Western Kurdistan. Thank you.
Pakistan makes this statement on behalf of OIC. Mr. Chairperson, we thank you for the floor. We acknowledge the efforts by the organizers to bring stakeholders at one place in order to promote dialogue and cooperation on issues pertaining to minorities in situations of humanitarian crisis. It is a good platform to identify and analyze the best practices, challenges, and prospective solutions to the issues that are faced by minorities in the situation of humanitarian crisis. Respect for humanity for us is one of the fundamentals of Islam. Islam is a religion of peace and advocates the unity of mankind. The Holy Quran says, O mankind, we have created you male and female and have made you nations and tribes that you may know one another. Respect of pluralism and diversity are therefore central to our belief system. OIC continues to promote initiatives for peace and unity and also for the safeguarding of rights of minorities, including the right to identity. OIC strongly condemns violence against all minorities, particularly human rights violations against displaced and vulnerable people targeted because of their racial, ethnic, and religious belongings. Today, the world is confronted with many humanitarian crises. Affected communities bear hardships and tremendous trauma in such crises. The anguish is often multiplied in the case of vulnerable segments of the society, such as minorities. Racial and structural discrimination, xenophobia, hate speech, absence of access to justice, political exclusion, socio-economic marginalization, incitement to hatred which leads to violence are issues that are faced by minorities in situations of humanitarian crisis. The intensity of such violence is magnified for the people under occupation. Mr. Chairperson, it is important to create conditions for the effective participation of minorities in political, social, economic, cultural sphere on the basis of equality and non-discrimination. The societies that are based on mutual trust and respect have the potential to overcome the forces of hatred, which try to divide us on the basis of ethnicity, religion, language or nationality. Good quality education can also help to raise the level of awareness of the rights of the persons belonging to minorities. Moreover, the need to empower women belonging to minorities cannot be overemphasized. The OIC is of the view that the predicament of the minorities in the situations of humanitarian crisis can be addressed by adhering to the principles of humanity, justice and non-violence, which are central to the teachings of Islam and all the great religions. In this regard, it is important to call for the compliance with the rule of law and humanitarian principles and to allow access of humanitarian aid agencies to affected people, victims of natural disasters or conflicts, managing diversity by recognizing plural identities and their specific needs is a sine qua non for any stable society. Our main objective should be that no one should be left behind in the access of humanitarian assistance and development process. This can be achieved by greater inclusivity of all the segments of society in decision making, developing norms that promote judicious and equitable societies abiding by international law and respecting basic human rights. Access to humanitarian assistance by the vulnerable groups like minorities become an even greater challenge in the situation of humanitarian crisis. We believe that sharing of best practices, promotion of understanding and the strengthening of dialogue can address many of the issues related to minorities in the situation of humanitarian crisis. Thank you, Mr. Chairperson.
I now give the floor to Centre Zagro pour les droits de l'homme. You have the floor.
الرئيس نيابة عن مركز زغروس لحقوق الإنسان أود أن ألفت انتباه.
I'm from the Agros Human Rights Centre and I'd like to tell you about the difficult situation in Turkey, especially in the Kurdish region in the southeast of the country. After June 2015 elections, some progress was made in Turkey. Unfortunately, the peace process stalled in July 2015. Violence broke out and the peace process collapsed. There were murders, assassinations, and flagrant human rights violations. There were cases of torture, detention, and forced disappearance. In December 2015, on the 16th December, the Turkish forces carried out operations in the Kurdish regions, targeting in particular the towns of Jazira and Saluki on the border between Iraq and Syria. These towns became battlefields and militarized zones. The people had to flee their land following the 2016 coup d'etat. The Turkish government took undemocratic measures against the opposition. Members elected in municipalities of these Kurdish regions were forced to flee or else were detained. On 25th October 2016, 11 parliamentarians from the Kurdish Democratic Party were imprisoned. President Salah Adin was imprisoned on 4th November 2016. Our organization, sir, is extremely concerned at the deterioration of the human rights situation in Turkey. This situation will become catastrophic, so we are requesting a general investigation into recent violations. We ask the Special Rapporteur on Minorities to prepare a comprehensive report on violations of Kurdish minorities in Turkey. We ask all parties to the conflict to come back to the process of peace.
Muchas gracias por esta.
Thank you very much for your statement. I now give the floor to the distinguished delegation of Italy.
Thank you, Mr. President. We consider very appropriate and timely the choice to develop during this forum the issue of the protection of minorities in humanitarian crises, as minorities are among the most vulnerable groups when such crises occur. Italy has been deeply committed in those years to raise the attention of the international community in this regard. The protection of minorities in humanitarian crises requires a multidimensional response, not only political, but also of immediate assistance on the ground to meet the most urgent needs with a medium-term vision allowing the coexistence of minorities in the post-conflict phase. States and those who have institutional responsibilities and in civil society must encourage and promote intercultural and interreligious dialogue. Education for diversity is an important antidote to the seeds of intolerance and violent extremism. On the occasion of the World Humanitarian Summit held in Istanbul last May, Italy stressed the importance of involving religious organizations in humanitarian action. They often have access to areas unreachable for the international community, and their contribution can be decisive for the delivery of aid to the besieged and isolated areas. The protection of cultural and religious heritage is an essential element for the protection of freedom of religion or belief and rights of ethnic and religious minorities. We support UNESCO's initiatives for the protection of cultural heritage in areas of crisis, and we have provided the support of an Italian task force that involves Carabinieri officers. As regards engagement on the ground, we also wish to underline the support of the Italian cooperation to the work of UNICEF in Iraq in assisting girls, mostly minors, belonging to the Yazidi minority, freed after being kidnapped by Daesh. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you very much to the distinguished delegation of Italy for this statement. I now give the floor to Zero Discrimination Association. You have the floor.
Mr. Chairperson, distinguished participants, representative of Zero Discrimination Association will read his statement in Turkish, and I'll read its translation in English.
Sayın Başkan, saygıdeğer katılımcılar, Türkiye, Suriye'den gelen büyük sayıda mülteciye ev sahipliği yapmaktadır. 2016 yılı resmi verilerine göre Türkiye'de yaşayan Suriyeli mülteci sayısı 3 milyondur. Bu rakamın 40-50 binini mülteci çingenelerin oluşturduğu tahmin edilmektedir.
Turkey has been hosting a high number of refugees from Syria. According to official statistics for 2016, the number of Syrian refugees living in Turkey is 3 million. 40-50,000 of these are estimated to be Roma.
Suriye'den gelen çingeneler, kamplarda yaşayanlar tarafından etnik kökenleri ve dini inançları nedeniyle ayrımcılığa uğramaları ve ön yargılı yaklaşmalarından dolayı mülteci kamplarında yaşamak istememektedirler.
Roma communities arriving in Turkey from Syria do not want to live in refugee camps as they are treated with prejudice and discrimination by other residents of the camps.
Roma mülteciler kamplarda kalmak yerine çoğunlukla Türkiye'deki çingene mahallelerinde ya da mahallelerin yakınındaki kendi çadırlarında 2 metrekarelik odalarda ya da parklarda yaşamayı tercih ediyorlar.
Instead of staying in the camps, they generally live in or near neighborhoods inhabited by other Roma living in Turkey, in self-established tent cities, 2 square meter rooms or parks.
Çingene mültecilerin sık sık yer değiştirmeleri nedeniyle kayıt altına alınması zorlaşıyor. Bunun sonucunda bazı Roma mülteciler diğer mültecilere sağlanan mevcut insani yardımlardan yararlanamıyor, sağlık ve eğitim hizmetlerine erişemiyorlar.
The fact that Roma refugees do not remain in one place for a long time makes it difficult for them to be registered. As a result of this, some of Roma refugees do not benefit from humanitarian aids provided to other refugees, do not have access to health services and schools.
Roma mültecilerin şartlarının iyileştirilmesi, uluslararası toplumun ilgisizliği ve Roma mülteci alanında çalışan sivil toplum örgütlerinin bu topluluklarla ilgili farkındalığa sahip olmamaları nedeniyle pek kolay görünmemektedir.
Improving the situation of Roma refugees is not that easy, as there is lack of interest within the international community and NGOs working on the subject are not much aware of the unique situation of Roma refugees.
İnsani yardım programları Roma mültecilerin özel ihtiyaçlarını dikkate almamaktadır. Roma STK'larla işbirliği yapılması, Romanlara kamplarda ayrımcılık yapılmasının önlenmesi ve kamplar dışında yaşayan Romanlara ulaşılması konusunda özel tedbirlerin alınmasını öneririz. İnsani yardım programlarının Roma mültecilerin özel ihtiyaçlarını dikkate alarak planlanıp uygulanmasını öneririz. Teşekkür ederim.
Humanitarian aid programs do not address the specific situation of Roma refugees. We would like to recommend that special measures are taken to cooperate with Roma NGOs to prevent discrimination against Roma in camps and to reach Roma outside of camps. We also recommend that humanitarian aid programs are designed and implemented in a way to address the special needs of Roma refugees. Thank you.
Thank you for your statement. I now give the floor to the distinguished delegation of Greece.
Mr. Chair? Oh, sorry. You haven't quit here. Mr. Chair, Madam Special Rapporteur, on behalf of the Hungarian delegation, I wish to warmly welcome you and to commend your outstanding work of the last 5 years. With regard to the ever-growing number of humanitarian crises erupting in different parts of the world and to the dramatically rising volume of humanitarian needs, we deem the choice of the theme for your report as particularly timely. We agree that because of their vulnerable situation within societies, the respect for and protection of the rights of minorities during humanitarian crises represent an increased challenge, especially when minority communities are the main targets of conflicts. It is extensively documented that during and in the aftermath of humanitarian crises or disasters, minorities are particularly exposed to the danger of becoming victims of physical violence. There is also a high occurrence of cases when humanitarian emergency relief does not reach minorities living in remote or conflict areas. We agree that mapping of the situations and specific needs of minorities, elaborating targeted and comprehensive strategies for times of crisis, responding to these specificities is a must. For this, reliable and precise data on how humanitarian crises are affecting minorities are indispensable. Both the volume and the kind of humanitarian aid are in general determined on the basis of disaggregated data by gender or age. That is why we attach key importance to the implementation of the Sendai framework for disaster risk reduction, stressing the key role of collection, analysis, management and use of disaggregated data in risk assessment and prevention. International instruments give states a clear legal framework for minority protection. Minorities, even in situations of humanitarian crisis, are under the protection of Article 27 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the 47/135 Declaration proclaimed by the General Assembly defines the way how to achieve it. Minority protection is one of Hungary's main priorities. The compulsory application of the declaration has been declared in bilateral treaties. Moreover, we would like to draw the attention to the situation of religious minorities in today's humanitarian crisis areas, especially with regard to Christian communities who are victims of violence, intolerance and discrimination. In order to follow the cases and to coordinate the government's response to the persecution of Christian minorities worldwide, a special unit has been established on ministerial level. Madam Special Rapporteur, in your report you are stressing that in order to prevent crisis and mitigate the disproportionate impact of crisis on minorities, states and non-state actors should establish an institutional framework for ensuring attention to minority issues within relevant national bodies. We would like to ask you how, by what means or procedures, institutional or legal gaps that exist at national level in many countries could be filled in order to collect and manage the required disaggregated data. Thank you.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you to the distinguished delegation of Hungary. I will now give the floor to the distinguished delegation of Greece, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would like to begin by stating that my country aligns itself with the statements of the European Union. I would also like to express our appreciation for the 9th session of the Forum on Minority Issues, as well as our esteemed gratitude for the work of the rapporteur, and we wish her all the best in her future endeavors. Being the birthplace of democracy and dialogue, and a strong supporter of the rule of law, Greece cannot but fully uphold and support the idea and concept which is guiding this forum. We are in favor of different, varied ideas and opinions being heard and discussed. These principles, among others, are enshrined within the Greek Constitution, which safeguards and protects the right of all citizens of Greece, including members of the Muslim minority in Thrace. Throughout the years, Greece has been faced with many challenges, challenges that have been overcome due to the unity and resilience of its people. This has also been recently demonstrated, in particular with regard to the ongoing refugee migration crisis. It is the same unity and resilience of the Greek people that has resulted in saving thousands of lives and assisting thousands of people in need in the aftermath of acute humanitarian crisis in their countries of origin. This alone is testimony to the extent of respect and support we attribute to the citizens of other countries, including those fleeing from conflict and humanitarian crisis, many of whom belong to minorities in their respective countries, let alone the citizens of Greece. As explained in detail during last May's UPR review, Greece has adopted a series of measures and is implementing a number of policies which aim at improving conditions and services offered to vulnerable groups. It has also substantially improved its anti-racist legislative framework by adopting measures against hate speech. One of the many examples in this regard is the establishment of a national board against racism and intolerance, with the participation of independent bodies such as the National Commission of Human Rights and the Ombudsman, as well as civil society, all of whom are tasked inter alia with the drafting of a national action plan against racism and intolerance. It is therefore evident that some comments heard yesterday in this room about the Muslim minority in Thrace are irrelevant both to the matter at hand, which is the specific theme of our forum, and also to the situation on the ground. I would like to conclude by saying that Greece and its people, despite the difficult and complex financial situation that we'll face, will continue to show respect and humanity to all those in need by honoring the moral obligation to observe humanitarian principles and by giving priority to the protection of the most vulnerable groups, as well as by respecting the obligations arising from UN and EU memberships and from our participation to other relevant international treaties. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you to the distinguished delegate from Greece. I now give the floor to the distinguished delegation of Norway.
Thank you, Mr. President. We would like to thank the Special Rapporteur for bringing in a minority perspective in the discussion of humanitarian crisis. In her recommendation to this year's forum, the Special Rapporteur has brought insight to the discussion and is mentioning a number of key elements. As the Special Rapporteur has suggested, it is indeed important to ensure registration of all those affected or displaced by crisis. However, we must keep in mind the reluctance of affected minorities to identify themselves as minority, whether ethnic, religious or otherwise, in fear of further discrimination or violence being one. This must be tackled. The Special Rapporteur has suggested that the displaced population should be free to specify any characteristic relative to their identity, and equally free to choose whether or not they are to be identified as belonging to a minority group. This is of great importance. For your information, Mr. President, in December here in Geneva, the Norwegian Church Aid, in cooperation with the World Council of Churches, will launch a report on how minorities are affected by the conflicts in Syria and Iraq. The report aims at giving humanitarian actors advice as to the needs of minorities. The report concludes that humanitarian responses need to take the diversity of religious minority into account in order to meet critical needs of people affected by conflicts and give short as well as long-term approaches. Mr. President, allow me finally to make three brief observations. First, human disasters may be very different. Natural disasters may bring true hardship over a minority community living in a region which is difficult to access, while an internal armed conflict may bring minorities directly into the armed conflict. That is why, for many reasons, the Special Rapporteur's call for disaggregated data seems legitimate. Second, Norway would also like to bring to your attention the challenges of multiple discrimination. Women are often discriminated and fall victims to sexual violence. Special attention should be given to this challenge. And third, more knowledge of the situation for minorities in humanitarian crisis may help us in developing risk assessment and early warning mechanism. In conclusion, Mr. President, I would like to reconfirm that Norway fully supports a minority rights-based approach during crisis, and in general we support the draft recommendations presented in the document before us. I thank you very much.
Thank you to the distinguished delegation of Norway. I now give the floor to Mr. Andra Bethlendi.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Andras Bethlendi. I am a lawyer and activist of the Musai Musai advocacy group from Cluj-Napoca, Colojvar, Romania. In the case of the Hungarian minority, language is considered to be the major identity marker. Representation of the Hungarian language in the public space marks the level of accommodation of a minority culture by the society at large. In my city, where 50,000 Hungarians live, the use of the Hungarian language in the public space is discriminated against. Despite the law guaranteeing the official use of Hungarian language in public, the mayor's office opposes consistently the enforcement of the latter of law. For instance, there are no bilingual place name signs or any other public signs. Therefore, my organization dedicates its activities to the protection of minority language rights. I will comment on the draft recommendations from this perspective. A critical component of all emergency planning and assistance is communication. Minority groups whose members have limited proficiency in the majority language are more exposed to discriminatory treatment, including multiple and intersecting forms of discrimination, if they are not communicated with in their mother tongue. We support draft recommendation number 23, paragraph F, on states' commitment to establish or continue to maintain open communication channels with affected communities and provide timely information in a format and language that is appropriate and culturally tailored to the specific minority groups. However, in the decision of the appropriate language, minority communities should be included or minority language should be used by default. We would also like to draw the attention to the fact that service provisions in crisis cannot meet the standard of equal treatment if they are not available in the mother tongue of the affected persons. Therefore, it is imperative that whenever relevant, recommendations make provisions to ensure the delivery of services in minority language. Since the appropriate protection and treatment of people who suffered traumatization or persecution in crisis have to be a priority, we emphasize that treatment needs to be secured in the language best understood by the affected persons. Therefore, draft recommendations number 23 and number 25 should reflect this need. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Ms. Beth Lendy, for your statement. I now give the floor to Minority Rights Group.
Mr. President, Madam Special Rapporteur, distinguished delegates, minority civilian populations face many challenges in humanitarian crises, particularly with regard to access to basic services. In Somalia, displaced minority women continue to experience sexual violence at the hands of members of the dominant clans who act as gatekeepers to emergency assistance. Equal access is only ensured through independent monitoring. After the peace process ended in Turkey in July 2015, armed clashes spread across southeastern Turkey. The government declared blanket curfews in many places. Some have lasted for months. Adequate measures have not been taken to ensure that civilians, many of whom belong to the Kurdish community, can meet their basic needs, including access to food and health services. There are credible accounts of civilians being shot while trying to reach hospitals. According to figures compiled between August 2015 and August 2016, at least 321 civilians were killed in the zones where curfews were declared and clashes taking place. 73 sadly died as a result of not having access to emergency care. More than 300,000 children in the region have not had regular access to education, and according to one survey, 41% of the children have not been able to attend school. The curfews have also meant that independent monitoring groups have not been able to gain access to affected areas. Elsewhere in West Papua, independent monitoring also remains severely constrained despite a publicized opening to journalists in May 2015. Regarding the draft recommendations, MRG would therefore suggest the following in paragraph 23. In point E, to add the following: do not prevent access by independent monitoring groups, including media, in order to ensure transparency. And in point M, to add, quote, and basic services, unquote, after access to safety. And since I have little time left, Madam Special Rapporteur, Rita, since this is your last forum, on behalf of all my colleagues at Minority Rights Group, I wish to end by thanking you for your fantastic leadership and dedication these past years. Thank you.
Muy bien. Muchas gracias por esta.
Very well. Thank you very much for your statement. I now give the floor to the distinguished delegation of the Ukraine. You have the floor.
Thank you. My delegation draws attention to the situation with minorities in Crimea temporarily occupied by the Russian Federation. Since its illegal occupation and annexation in 2014, numerous international monitors have published reports on the situation in Crimea, including 15 OHCHR reports. These documents reflect ongoing serious and systematic abuses of the rights of persons belonging to minorities, especially Crimean Tatars, which include forced and retroactive implementation of the Russian laws, imposition of Russian citizenship, politically motivated incarceration and prosecution, restrictions on freedom of expression and belief, intimidation of journalists and systematic harassment and disruption of the news media in Crimean Tatar and Ukrainian languages. Crimean Tatars suffer killings, enforced disappearances, police brutality, arbitrary searches, arrests, torture, ill treatment, unfair trials, discriminatory legislation, effective proscription of Crimean Tatar language, seizure and violation of their properties, etc. These crimes and violations are not properly investigated and those responsible are not brought to justice. Representatives of the UN system are not allowed to attend Crimea, as it happened, for example, with Special Rapporteur on Minority Issues Rita Izhak in April 2014. The ongoing deterioration of the situation in Crimea causes, among other consequences, increasing number of IDPs leaving the peninsula. In this regard, we are pleased to see you, Mr. Biani, among the panelists, as you were able to see for yourself the situation with IDPs, including from the occupied Crimea, during your visits to Ukraine. And we thank you for mentioning this situation in your presentation. Could you please elaborate on what could be done more by the UN machinery to prevent further violations of minorities' rights in temporarily illegally occupied Crimea and to stop further expulsion of minorities from the peninsula? I will also briefly respond to the statement made earlier by one of the NGOs regarding alleged so-called IDPs crisis in Ukraine. The Ukrainian government recognizes that the situation with IDPs, the number of which has reached 1.7 million, is serious and is doing its best to meet their needs. However, we would like to emphasize that IDPs, including minorities, are forced to flee their homes precisely because of external military aggression against Ukraine by the Russian Federation, and the real purpose of the anti-terrorist operation is stabilization of the situation in Ukraine, which the Russian Federation is striving to undermine by all possible means. Thank you.
Thank you very much to the Distinguished Delegation of Ukraine for their statement. I now give the floor to the UN Fellow for People of African Descent.
Good afternoon, Mr. President, Special Rapporteur, and esteemed participants of this forum. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to this privileged forum. I'm Ketanya Petgrave from Jamaica, representing the 2016 Fellows of People of African Descent, a program for human rights advocates organized by the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. We would like to address the following issues concerning people of African descent regarding humanitarian crises in migration. The current global migration is overshadowed by a humanitarian and human rights crisis. As you know, the number of migrants who have died crossing the Mediterranean Sea are astronomical. A 2016 IOM report states that 2,901 people died en route while crossing from Africa to Europe during the period January to June 2016, in 6 months only. Other charities such as the Spanish NGO Movimiento por la Paz and Doctors Without Borders have recorded similar figures. We will never know the real figures because these are estimates based primarily on survivors' testimonies. Their president and special rapporteur, the vast majority of the people are of African descent, fleeing because of war, political instability, and persecution from countries including those from northeastern and northwestern Africa. Many are preyed upon by smugglers and violated by national authorities, according to the above-mentioned IOM report. If they are fortunate enough to arrive to countries in Europe, such as Germany and France, through other countries including Spain and Italy, they face systematic racism, racial discrimination, xenophobia, and Afrophobia. Their basic access to human rights are limited. They lack access to basic health services, accommodation needs, and work permits. We would also like to highlight the humanitarian needs of women and children of African descent who suffer from intersectionalities of race, gender, and other forms of discrimination, and as such are vulnerable to harassment, violence, human trafficking, and prostitution. We remind the United Nations and member states that the problem of Afrophobia, systematic racism, racial discrimination, xenophobia, and related intolerance still exist and has to be urgently dealt with in the context of the International Decade for People of African Descent and the Sustainable Development Goals. Without the promotion of migrant and minorities' rights, including those of African descent, we will not achieve the desired goals. Hence, we recommend to the forum the following: to prioritize the humanitarian and human rights needs of migrants of African descent, especially women and children, and respect their rights and dignity. And two, to, in compliance and in the spirit of conventions like the International Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, the International Convention on the Protection of Rights of All Migrant Workers and Members of Their Families, and the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, we encourage global communities to support the institution of measures to address those in transit as they attempt to cross borders. Finally, we remind our international organizations of our shared responsibility of transforming our world and leaving no one behind. Thank you.
Very well, thank you very much for your statement. I now give the floor to the Council Popular of Chaldean Syriac Assyrians.
My name is Kamil Zuzu. I am a Christian Iraqi. I'm the German Bureau official of the Popular Council of Chaldean Syriac Assyrians. I would like, first of all, to pay tribute to the heroes of the Iraqi army, the Peshmerga, the popular mobilization units, and the Christian forces who are fighting ISIL in order to liberate Nineveh and Mosul. 150,000 Christians have been displaced. 115 have been killed and 161 have been kidnapped, and their fate continues to be unknown. 79 have been victims of rape and sexual enslavement. 15 women of them have been liberated, according to the biannual report of Shlomo, an organization dedicated to the documentation of violations against Christians in Iraq. In spite of all this suffering, the killing and displacement that we have been subjected to, the Iraqi government, in addition to all that, is clamping down on the rights of minorities. The Iraqi Council of Representatives on October 22, 2016, adopted a bill to ban alcoholic beverages based on Islamic law. This is a violation of the Iraqi Constitution, specifically Articles 3, 14, 15, and 17. We would like to draw your attention also to the fact that Iraq continuously looks for legislative opportunities to Islamize society, especially when faced with great challenges. In October of 2015, the Iraqi Council of Representatives enacted a law to Islamize minors who are non-Muslim, who are under 18. In accordance with the item 26 of the unified ID card. That is at the time where ISIL occupies a third of the Iraqi territory. Minorities such as Christians, Yazidis, Sabaeans, Mandaeans cannot live under this decision. This adds to greater migration of our people from Iraq, not to mention the killings and the seizure of our property in the capital Baghdad through illegal means. Such decisions are contrary to efforts to build a civil and democratic state in a multi-ethnic and multiracial society in Iraq. In the name of humanity, we would like to make the following requests. One, to implement international resolutions, including the European Parliament resolution issued in March 2015 and October 2016 in connection with international protection of minorities in Nineveh, and the development of an autonomous province in the Nineveh Plain and Sinjar in line with the Iraqi Constitution. Two, to urge the UN Security Council to refer the genocide against minorities perpetrated by ISIL to the International Criminal Court, especially as there are members of the Security Council that have recognized the genocide, that namely the UK and the US. Three, to continue the review of human rights in Iraq in view of consistent violations of human rights in Iraq in general and the violation of minorities' rights in particular. Four, to urge the Iraqi executive, legislative, and judicial powers in Iraq to protect the indigenous peoples, including our people in Babylon and Assyria, and to protect our culture and language, the language of Jesus Christ, which is Syriac. And five, to set up a reconstruction fund for Nineveh. Thank you.
Very well. I will now give the floor for the last speaker this morning, which is a request from Russia.
Спасибо.
Thank you, sir. We'd like to take the opportunity to exercise the right of reply. We protest the statement of the Ukrainian delegation using the words occupation and annexation with respect to the Russian Federation. You know our position on this. I won't repeat it here. Moreover, I'd like to point out that ignoring interests of minorities undermined the interest of the state and excluded a whole area from it. As for Crimean Tatars, their problems were not addressed for a long time. If you remember the report on the visit of Ms. Izhak to Ukraine, paragraph 49, this says that after conversations with representatives of Crimean Tatars, it was reported that land and property issues were not resolved by Ukrainian authorities, and this is what led to tensions between ethnic communities of that peninsula. These problems were reported also by other international human rights mechanisms, and only now have there been some areas of progress. I'd also like to add it's a pity that it's even in the context of this session here, the Ukrainian delegation has not remembered the real humanitarian crisis in the southeast of the country with victims of many thousands dead and many, many people displaced. Thank you.
Muy bien. Muchas gracias.
Very well. Thank you very much for this final statement from Russia. This morning's meeting has been very fruitful and intense. And we should all use this break until 3 p.m. I hope that you all recover your energies through rest and food, whatever you might choose, so that we are all ready when we meet again this afternoon.